and welcome to the Toledo Lucas County Public Library Sight and Sound Project. I'm Tom Walton. Our guest today is a man who was born in Toledo and went on to great fame in Hollywood. Actor, comedian, TV star, entertainer, all of these apply to Jamie Farr. But so does this. He's a man who never forgot his roots or his hometown. And Jamie, it's great to be with you again. Welcome home.
Thank you, Tom. It's always a pleasure to be here.
Let's talk a little bit about your childhood. We're going to get to M.A.S.H. in a bit. But
that's all right.
I want to talk about your childhood, your growing up years here in Toledo. Can you tell us about your neighborhood, some of your buddies, favorite memories? I know you were born July 1st, 1934, and a belated happy birthday.
Thank you.
But what was it like growing up in the north side?
Well, we lived in so many different places. I'm trying to remember as a really, really young child. I think one of the places I remember was on Erie Street. I think it was maybe Erie and Magnolia. It was a downstairs place. And I remember my mother would say to me, I always got in trouble. I was always busy trying to get into the cupboards in the kitchen. And one time she wasn't looking, and I guess I climbed up onto the counter and got up to one of the higher cupboards and opened it up, and there was olive oil that was there. I was going after some cookies, and there was some olive oil up there, and I went to get it, and I came down. And I scraped my whole side here, and the olive oil came down and was going bloop, bloop, bloop on the floor. That's what my mother heard. She came running in, and she couldn't believe what she had seen. And I also had scraped the side of my rib cage here. And, you know, to this day, I have a scar there from that.
And I would imagine to this day you've never again climbed on a kitchen counter.
Well, yes, I do, as a matter of fact. I do the flamingo on in my house.
Your father, Sam, operated a market at Locust in Ontario.
Locust in Ontario.
Your mom, Jamelia, was, I believe, a seamstress.
Correct.
At the time. Can you talk about your parents?
Sure. My mother was born in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. I forgot the year she was born there. My father was born in Lebanon, a village called Jibjani. My mother was the second oldest of nine children, and her mother was very sick. My first grandmother was very, very ill, and so my grandfather decided to take my mother and and her older sister. Her name was Bertha. My mother's name was Jamelia. Actually, Bertha's real Lebanese name was Wadia. So my grandfather Joseph was going to take his wife Philomena with Wadia and Jamelia to Lebanon because I believe my grandmother had tuberculosis, and they wanted to see if the weather change would do it from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. So my mother and my aunt and my grandparents went there, and while they were there, her mother passed away, Philomena did. So they lived there for a few years, and then they decided, my grandfather decided to remarry. And he married the first cousin of Philomena, and her name was Tamim. And they decided to come back to America, and they took a ship, and they stopped in Marseille to pick up a cousin. And the cousin was late. So my grandfather had the choice of taking his new bride and my mother and her sister on the ship that they were designated to go on, or wait for my cousin, the cousin. And the mother of the cousin said, you've got to stay. I want my son to go to America. And so my grandfather was reluctant, but he was convinced. So they decided not to take the ship. Well, as it turned out, the ship was the Titanic. It went from Southampton to Marseille and then on to New York. So I said in my book, I said, I want to thank a cousin who I never met, who saved my life before I was born, because my mother obviously would have been on that Titanic ship. They moved back to Cedar Rapids. And then around the turn of the century, my father and his brother, my father's name actually was Salim, but they called him Sam. And because he was a butcher, they called him Butch. And his brother, Amin, but they called him Emil, came to America, and they originally went to Montana. They had the marcelled hair and the big handlebar mustaches and the silk shirts, and then they wound up in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Why people who come from the Middle East, where they have this wonderful weather, would want to go to Montana or Cedar Rapids, Iowa. I have no idea, but that's where they wound up. And eventually, my father met my mother, and in those days, I think my mom was 17 years old, the marriages were arranged. So she didn't just, I fell in love, and so my grandfather, as long as he could support her and look after her, and my mother really liked somebody else. I can't think of the man's name. And
probably just as well that you can't think of.
Yeah, and he had come to court her, and he had a business someplace else, and my grandfather got mad at him for some reason that he wasn't going to do something for my mother, and he just curtailed the marriage, just like that. He had that power to do that, and I'm sure that made my mother quite angry, because she really was smitten by this person. And anyway, the marriage was arranged, and so my father, Sam, or Salim, and Jamelia got married, and they moved to Sioux City, Iowa. My dad had gotten work with I'm trying to remember the company. It was a meat packing company, Swift and Company. And then my sister was born, I think 1924, Yvonne. And they lived there for quite some time. And then I think what brought them to Toledo was a job opportunity. So they packed up and moved here. And then 10 years later, I was the accident. I often wonder if they're, you know, because my mother was a real feminist. I wonder if there were certain rights at that time, whether I'd be here right now, because that was a shock.
Your family ended up in Toledo, and you settled north side.
Yeah, the north end.
LaGrange Elementary, I think?
Eventually I was in LaGrange. But we lived all over the north end. We lived on Erie Street, we lived on Superior Street, we lived on Magnolia Street, we lived on Mulberry Street. We only had one house that we lived in, and I think that was on Mulberry Street, and it was a man by the name of Charlie Hyder owned it. It was a great house. It had three bedrooms and a bath in it, and the basement. And of course, I forgot how old I was when we were there. It was right by an alleyway, and we had the coal bins then, and naturally I had to go down and make sure I stoked the furnaces before everybody went to bed to make sure that we had heat in the house in the wintertime. And we loved that house. It had one bathroom, if I remember correctly. And my mother really wanted to buy the house. It cost $3,500 at the time. And my dad didn't have the money, so they went to my dad's brother to get a loan. I think they needed $300 or $600 or whatever it is. And for some reason, I don't know what it is, I think that my mother and his wife, they were kind of on the out, so she never got the money, so we never got the house. From that time on, we lived in duplexes, which were upstairs. But I got to tell you, that coal bin, we used to go down there all the time. My mother canned, because we had the basement, I remember good clean coal from the Ackerman Coal Company. They'd stick that chute down there, and you'd hear that coal going down into the basement. We used to, in the summertime, we used the coal bin as a clubhouse. That's where we all met. I don't know if you did
got
that.
Got a little dirty in the process.
Yeah, it did. We got some little smudges on us. Yeah. And my dad had won a duck. And we kept the duck down there, and I used to go down there and feed the duck, and then one day I discovered that the duck wasn't a pet, he was a meal. And I think I gave him a name. It wasn't Donald, but it was something like that. I passed it on that one.
You went to LaGrange Elementary, you said later Woodward High School,
yeah.
And you were president of your junior class at
what? I was president. You couldn't run for freshman president, but I was president of sophomore, junior, and senior
all
class.
Three. All was three. That the limits of your political career? Did
yes.
You have any aspirations beyond
no,
that?
No, I had no. I have no aspiration. I wouldn't be a politician for anything in the world. The old you're darned if you do, and you're darned if you
well,
don't.
Evidently, you didn't want to be a journalist either, because
no, I was on the school paper.
You were on the school paper, the
yeah.
Tattler.
Yes, correct.
Apparently, journalism's loss was Hollywood's gain.
No. You know, I really do like writing, and you have my book there. And although it says it's co-authored by somebody, those are really my stories. And if you read it, it sounds like me talking.
Does.
So
it does.
That's why I did it. Because they start to write and they get very floral, and I said, no. It's like I'm talking to somebody. That's
right.
The way I wanted.
Now, you were in the drama club at Woodward. Was that when the acting bug first bit
actually
you?
It wasn't, there wasn't a drama club. It was a radio. We had the broadcaster, broadcasting class. It was Mrs. Matheny, Dorothy Matheny. And it was so much fun. We had the we had a booth, soundproof booth there, and the microphones. And I remember The Ghost of Benjamin Sweet. That was one of the first radio shows that we did. And then we got a couple of Jack Benny scripts. And then we would try to emulate Jack Benny's shows. And, of course, we listened to it on the radio. It was so much fun. And then we did it. We couldn't understand why it wasn't
didn't
funny.
Work so
yeah.
Well.
We needed Jack Benny and Rochester and Dennis Day and Mary Livingston, Don Wilson.
Well, when we talk about acting, and forgive me for jumping forward just a little bit, but long before M.A.S.H., there mm-hmm. was the Pasadena Playhouse. Your family moved out west.
Well, no. Here's what happened. I actually left here before my family went there. They were planning to move to Phoenix. My mother couldn't take the cold winters here anymore. The damp winters. She used to get up every morning and curse this city because of the weather. Can't tell you how many times you'd slip and fall outside your doorway, you know, with this, after the fresh snow would fall, everybody's footsteps would go in there, footprints, and then that would freeze.
Yeah.
You'd get caught in that, and then, so you'd throw the hot ashes or the salt out there to try to melt all that stuff. So she got fed up with it, and she wanted to move to Phoenix, Arizona. My uncle, her brother, one of the younger brothers, had moved to Tucson many, many years ago. My uncle was partially deaf, and he went to Tucson to teach the deaf-mute children there, and then he wound up in real estate, and she liked the weather there. I didn't have any money, really, to go. I probably could have tried to go to University of Toledo or Bowling Green State. I liked both of them, and I knew they had good drama classes there. But I had gotten a magazine called Theater Arts. I used to get it from Hamp's Drugstore on Bush Street there, right across from the Mystic Theater, where I saw all my movies for 12 cents and a nickel bag of popcorn that had all those grease spots at the bottom of it, but it was the best popcorn in the world.
Can't believe it.
And it was next to the fire station. They had the alarm inside the fire station. Firemen could get in free. And if there was a fire in the neighborhood, it'd ring in the theater. They'd all go running out. So anyway, I used to buy my Theater Arts magazine from a Hamp's Drugstore, and I'd go through it. It was wonderful. It was all about Broadway in New York, and they'd always have a play published in there. And I would read it. And in the back, they had ads. In the back of this one, they had Pasadena Playhouse, Theater of the Stars. And I said, boy, that sounds good. I think I'd like to go there. So I wrote a letter, and they would accept me if I had $600. I could have been accepted by any place, you know, if I had $600. So I said, dude, where am I going to get the $600? Well, in those days, we had purchased all of our war bonds and savings stamps that I picked up. And I cashed them all in. I had $600. Caught the train from downtown Toledo and went to Pasadena. And then I enrolled there. I didn't have much money. I lived in a little area that you shared the room with another person, had a community bathroom that was connected to another place that had two people in there. We used a community kitchen. And I just barely was making it. My dad would send me maybe $20 a month or something, and I would work on the weekends. I'd have to catch a bus and go into Hollywood area, and my sister was living there with her husband. But their apartment wasn't furnished completely. They just had their bedroom and dining room and living room furnished. The other bedroom just had a cot, an army cot in it. Mm-hmm. So I'd go there, sleep overnight on that army cot, work all day long in an army surplus store, get on the bus, go back to Pasadena and be in a play, which is part of our curriculum, and then have to catch the bus and come back in, sleep on the army cot, and work all day again, maybe 12 hours.
At least you knew at an early point that acting was hard work.
Yes, it was. Making a living was hard work. Earning money was hard work. So then I would go back and start my school.
You worked your way into early television, and you worked.
Well, no. What happened was I was doing a show on the main stage of the Pasadena Playhouse, and they were going to make a movie called Blackboard Jungle at MGM. Now, you have to understand, I had just come from Toledo watching movies at the Lowe's Valentine Theater, MGM movie, and this is like a year and a half passes now when this opportunity comes up, and this talent scout had me screen tested for one of the parts in this movie. And I didn't know anything about it. I guess it had been a popular book or something.
Was this Santini?
This is going to be Santini, yeah. And I screen tested actually the actor that I screen tested with, who was playing the Glenn Ford role in it, was James Drury, who later went on to be the Virginian in a TV series. I got the part, and I got an agent from that. And that was my first movie. I think I got $350 a week for it.
1955, I believe.
Was that? Yeah, it was. Well, I think it was released. Yeah, I think it was released in 55. We did it, I think, somewhere in 54, because I was going to say to you, here I am in Toledo watching an MGM movie, and then a year and a half later, I'm in Hollywood making an MGM movie. It was unbelievable.
You were born Jamil Farr.
Jamil Farr.
And when did that become shortened to Jamie Farr? How did that happen? Who suggested it?
I'm trying to remember. Well, in Hollywood, if your name is Jamil, you know, they call you Shlumiel. And if you change it to Jamie, they call you Jaime. So I just thought, I think it was a comedy act that we were putting together. I can't remember who I was with. Oh, it might have been my buddy Paul White, who was from Woodward High School. He's half Lebanese. His mother, I think, was a Hadad. And we thought that Farrah was, you couldn't say it, so we decided to go with Farr. Everybody would call me Jamie anyway, because they didn't want to call me Jamil. So that's, I think, how I adopted it. And the first time I used it professionally in a show, I think, was one that Andy Finity produced. And Andy was from here. Andy went to Woodward High School and also University of Toledo. Very fine writer and a producer. And it was a show that we did for NBC called Las Vegas Beat. It starred Peter Graves. And I think that's the first time that I used that on the screen.
You honed your skills, you learned your craft, and eventually the life-changing opportunity came along to do a show called M.A.S.H., and we do have to talk about that.
Oh, yeah.
So how did the role of Max Klinger come about?
Well, I think... first of all, the reason I got the part was because I had done a episode of F Troop that starred Forrest Tucker, Larry Storch, and Ken Berry. Very funny show. And a gentleman by the name of High Averback, who used to be Bob Hope's announcer and later went on to be a producer and then also a director. Gene Reynolds was the director. Gene Reynolds and High Averback were friends because High had also been an actor. Gene Reynolds was a child actor, and he was converting his career into becoming a director and maybe a producer. Well, he directed this particular episode, which I was a stand-up comic Indian in it, trying to impress the Hakawi tribe, and I had all these one-liner jokes that applied to Indians. And at the he liked me very much, and what he would do is, if he liked an actor, he would enter your name in a book. And when a specific part came up, he would go to that book. And this part, Larry Gelbart, who had written The Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum and a lot of other shows, was one of the Sid Caesar writers in the heyday of the show, along with Neil Simon and Woody Allen and a great number of great comedy writers. He came up with his character. It only had maybe 4 or 5 lines. So Gene said, hey, there's only one guy that can play this and get away with it. And Larry Gelbart said, who's that? And he said, Jamie Farr. Well, I was out of work at that time. As you know, actors are out of work. It's always feast or famine. And I was pretty desperate at that time. I was married to my wife, Joy, and we had a child, Jonas. And I was struggling. So the part came up. I had no idea what I was supposed to do. All they said is, Gene wants you to show up at the studio. It's $250 for the day. And he'll tell you the part when you get there. So the story goes, I get there, and he ushers me into a trailer outside of Stage 9 at 20th Century Fox, and there's a woman Army Corps uniform on a hanger with these huge high-heel shoes, and as I often say, I thought I was dressing with an actress, and he says, no, those are yours, put them on. So I put this dress on and these high heels, and he started laughing, took me onto the sound stage. People were laughing all over. Had 4 lines. The Halt, who goes there? Oh, Corporal Klinger still trying to get out of the army. Well, I'll still keep trying, Mary. And I skip off into the night with my rifle. Then I come back later. And then the other time, I had never seen the show. I hadn't seen the movie. I hadn't read the book. So I didn't know anything about M.A.S.H. I barely knew it was Mobile Army Surgical Hospital. And then at the end, supposedly I come out naked and to get out of the circus. They only shot me from the waist up. So
$250 you'll do what
you
want.
Yeah, $250, right. So they just thought that was great. They got a lot of laughs on it, and they kept bringing the character back. And that first season was on Sunday night opposite the Wonderful World of Disney. I did 6 shows, and then we were going to be canceled, because the show wasn't getting any ratings. And Bill Paley, who was the chairman of CBS, his wife, Babe Paley, liked the show. And she says, you know what, Bill, I think you ought to keep that show on. And as you and I know, when the wife says something, you better do it. So Bill Paley says, you know, that's a good idea. So he put us in on that Saturday night lineup in the second year that had like all of the family, Mary Tyler Moore, M.A.S.H., the Bob Newhart, and Carol Burnett show. Biggest night in the history of television.
Let's talk a little bit about Klinger. He desperately wanted out of the Army.
Yeah, but
he was a good soldier.
He was a good soldier, but here's the thing. I don't mean to interrupt
That's
your
right.
question, but I wanted to get to this. The reason why Klinger came from Toledo and did all these things. Actually, Klinger was the name of Larry Gelbart's childhood friend in Chicago, where Larry grew up. The reason why he made Klinger from Toledo is when Larry was a teenager, he was going to Fairfax High School in Los Angeles. It was the Jewish high school there. And his dad, Harry, was a barber. His barber shop was across the street from Fairfax High School. And Harry Gelbart was the barber to the comedians. And Milton Berle would go in there. Harry Ritz would go in there. Every well-known comedian, Eddie Cantor or whatever. Danny Thomas used to get his hair cut from Harry Gelbart. And Harry said, Danny, my son is a very funny kid. He writes material and everything else. Finally, he convinced Danny. He says, all right, let's see some of his jokes. Larry came over. Danny was in the barber shop, showed him the jokes. Danny liked them, and Danny was the first person that bought comedy jokes from Larry Gelbart. And that's why Larry, I thought it was like a payback to Danny to make my character Lebanese and make him from Toledo. So that's kind of an interesting story.
Wonderful story. But he really was a good soldier.
He was never derelict. Yeah, he was. He always wanted to do the right thing, and he was going to get out on his terms, not the terms that the psychiatrist would come in and say, "Well, I think you might have a problem, you know, sexual problem." No, wait a minute, you know, don't say that. I'm crazy.
I remember Alan Alda, who played Hawkeye Pierce, of course, saying once that he didn't want to do a show that was just about battlefield hijinks.
Right. I think that was his expression. Costello at the front, yeah.
And indeed, there was a deeper message to M.A.S.H.
Sure.
The war is a horrible thing, wasn't it?
Oh, of course.
That was what the message was.
Yeah, that was the message, yeah. And if you notice, you never saw anybody really using guns in it. You'd hear the explosions and everything else. They didn't want to show any of those things. What you saw was the remnants of war. You saw the after effects of people getting killed. And of course, the big show was the one where McLean Stevens and Colonel Blake, which had never been done in a TV series before, where a major character who's leaving the show actually gets killed. And you can't imagine the mail we got, the reaction we got when he was dead in that last scene. We didn't know about it.
I wanted to ask you about that because you had not been told. The cast had not been told what his fate was.
Right. What happened is we supposedly were saying goodbye to the colonel at the helicopter pad. He was on his way to go back to Illinois, Colonel Potter. Colonel Potter. I jumped ahead of myself here. Colonel Potter was Harry Morgan, Colonel Blake. And so we all said goodbye to him at the helicopter pad. I was in my Carmen Miranda outfit, and I remember he said, "I always liked that outfit, Klinger." And I said, "Sir, would you do me the honors?" And I turned around for him to use the zipper because it wasn't quite up. And I said, "That's up, sir, up, you know, the zipper." Anyway, we say goodbye to him. And I thought that was my final day of shooting, and I got a call from the studio. They said, they added one scene, it's in the operating room, would you come back? And they asked Loretta Swit and Alan Alda and everything, what could this scene be?
And you're in the scene with your surgical mask.
All surgical mask. They lined up the shot and still didn't tell us what the scene was because none of us had any dialogue in it. And then they called us aside, the complete cast. We went into a private room. And they gave the dialogue to Gary Berghoff, who was Radar. And he read it, and he read it out loud to us, and everybody was stunned. Some of them didn't like it. They actually opposed it. Some of them thought it was a great idea. And
how did you feel?
I was ambivalent. I was getting my $250 a day. I said, "Heck, if they want to get rid of it, it's okay with me." No, I was. I didn't make any issue out of it. I thought about it, and Mac wasn't coming back anyway. So that was a great way to show you the horrors of war. Mm-hmm. A character that you liked, which is like your own family, people that you love, they get killed in war. So why shouldn't this happen on a TV show? And that's when that line came out. Colonel Blake's helicopter was shot down over the Sea of Japan. There are no survivors.
Now, we sort of knew that Hawkeye was from Maine. Honeycutt, I believe, from the Bay Area in California. Radar from Ottumwa, Iowa.
Iowa.
But no character was more identified with his hometown than yours. And you explained how the Toledo connection came about, but...
Well, also Gene Reynolds actually was born in Cleveland, the producer and the director of a lot of the episodes, had moved to Detroit, and then went on to Hollywood, and of course, he always remembered Toledo, and Toledo, if you mentioned Toledo in a movie or something, it always got a big laugh. I mean, I watched some old movies, they said, "Yeah, we got to play Toledo," you know, or something, and then big laugh, and the other thing was that one of our writers had grown up in an area where the Toledo Mud Hens had played. And he just thought that was the greatest thing. It was one of the minor league teams that came in. And he just loved the Toledo Mud Hens. So what perfect thing. I mean, you got this bizarre character called Klinger who's from Toledo. Why not have him adore the Toledo Mud Hens? I mean, they did research. There isn't a team anywhere called the Mud Hens. There are Panthers, Lions, all kinds. But there isn't any team called the Mud Hens. It's the original name of a team. So that's how that came about. And then Gene Cook, who was then the general manager of the Mud Hens, started sending us things for me to wear on the show. And that's
of course,
how
Tony Packles, that was another big part.
Tony Packles was an accident. We were doing a show. It was a show that wasn't written. They had tried to duplicate what Edward R. Murrow had done by going over to Korea and interviewing all the GIs. And they liked that idea. So they got Cleet Roberts, who was a very fine war correspondent. He was also a local broadcaster in L.A. And I think Cleet had also worked with Edward R. Murrow. And what Larry Gelbart did is he took us aside. He had a tape recorder. And he asked us questions, pretty much what you're doing right now, but he asked us questions as our characters. So we responded.
You didn't know what was coming.
I had no idea. So when he asked me, I had to rely on my backstory of who I was as Klinger, just as Alan Alda had to do when he was playing Hawkeye and he came from Maine. So I just used all the things that I recalled as a child. I happened to mention Tony Pacos. I happened to mention the Mud Hens on all these things. Street corners, names of streets that I had. And so Larry then went back and he kind of typed out a transcript. Used that and typed out kind of a sketchy thing. And then when Cleet Roberts came in to interview us, Cleet would use that and then we tried to kind of remember what we said. It wasn't written. It was all and that won the Peabody Award, that the particular I think it was a 1 hour episode.
I remember that one.
Yeah.
I know the high regard you have for all of that wonderful cast members on MASH, and I know it's reciprocated, Jamie. Gary Berghoff, who played Radar, has been to Toledo to see you.
He's quite an artist, you know, and a great musician.
Yes, he is indeed a wonderful
artist. He's retired now, incidentally. Mm-hmm. He's retired, and I believe he lives in Connecticut somewhere.
Mike Farrell's been here. I saw him at a Mud Hens game with you.
That's correct.
A few years ago, Loretta Swit was a surprise guest for you when the press club roasted you. Those folks are all special people in your life. That was a cast that truly loved each other, wasn't it?
It was, because most of us started in the theater, and we had that theater background. It wasn't as if we came from some university or something like that. We all started out and we all struggled. Although Alan Alda went to Fordham, but Alan's dad, Robert Alda, was a big name on Broadway and been a star at Warner Brothers for years. But we all struggled in the theater. And I think we had this camaraderie. And also, we always knew the play was the thing. Unlike some of the shows you get on where the actors have huge egos and they're only looking for how much dialogue they're going to get, it wasn't like that. We used to say, you know what, this character wouldn't say that. I think that you might be able to say this, but can I give you that line? Is that all right if I give him the line? And we used to do that. Well, the producers and the directors couldn't believe that there was a cast that would be willing to not say certain words and things. And it wasn't with a belligerency. It was, that's the way we felt it would be wrong. And we'd have discussions. And then they would agree with us, and that's how we would get along with the show. And we would rehearse when they were setting up the camera for a scene. Unlike other actors on the phone, you know, with their press agent or finding out where they're going to be and can I get there and how much money can I get, we were off in a private room someplace going over the lines, doing it just like we did in a play, so that you wouldn't have to stop to think. The lines would come automatically.
Now, MASH had a wonderful run, 11 years or so, I believe,
yes.
And its final episode in 1983 was watched by 125 million viewers, and I think that's still the most watched primetime TV show in the history of the medium. Do you still marvel at that?
Yes. Well, but I also know the reason why. Population of the United States was 200 million at that time. I think we're, over 300 million now when this is being recorded. And can you imagine 125 million people watching the same show out of 200? I mean, that is incredible. But you have to remember there were only three networks at the time. And today you've got all these cable channels. That's why other shows like Seinfeld and Cheers and so forth, there's too much competition. There are too many other. There's four networks, a lot of cable. So there were just three networks at that time, a couple of, I think, news cable channels, and that's why I think we were so superior.
Now, sometime later after MASH ended, you and Harry Morgan, I think, who played Colonel Potter, did another show called After MASH for a couple of years.
Right, Harry and Bill Christopher and I did,
Wasn't quite the same. Did you miss that marvelous ensemble that you were part of?
You know what? This has been brought up several times. We had a great ensemble. The problem was... there's going to be some negative things coming out now. See, Alan Alda was the crux of MASH, and the network deemed him to be that. So Alan had a lot of influence with the network and with the writers. When we did Aftermath, it was never the show I had envisioned. And they wouldn't listen to me because I didn't have the elan of Alan Alda. And Harry Morgan wasn't about to, and they weren't going to listen to Bill Christopher, William Christopher. And it was a very unhappy experience for me. I had the same people that I adored and loved that were controlling the show. We were now at odds, and they just refused. I knew we were headed in the wrong direction with it. They didn't stay with the characters. They tried to change my character, and then he brought in other characters that just didn't work.
The magic wasn't there.
The magic wasn't there, and I kept saying to him, you remember a movie called The Best Years of Our Lives? That's what I wanted it to be after the war. But they kept trying to go in another direction, and the characters didn't have a depth to them. They were surface characters. You just didn't believe them, and it didn't work. And it was a great disappointment for me.
Now, all the while you built a successful career on television, you were yearning to do Broadway, and finally along came a dream opportunity, a dream role, Nathan Detroit in Guys and Dolls on Broadway. That had to be an exciting opportunity.
Well, I had seen the very first Broadway type show I'd ever seen was here at Toledo at the Paramount Theater. They had brought in Guys and Dolls, and I was an usher. I was still in high school, and the lead in that was a road company was Jack Jones's father, Alan Jones, wonderful singer. He played Sky Masterson, and I saw that show. And I couldn't believe the music, and I couldn't believe the dialogue, and I said, you know what? Someday, I would love to play that part of Nathan Detroit. Yeah, on Broadway, Robert Alda played it. Alan's dad played Sky Masterson, and Sam Levine, wonderful actor, played Nathan Detroit. And years later, we're doing M.A.S.H., and there's an actor who was traveling with a company of Grease. And he had a small part on our show. And he said, you know, Jamie, things are bad. And then I gave him a pep talk. And I said, you got to do this and that. And then his name is Jerry Zaks. Jerry Zaks went on to become a director on Broadway. And I didn't even know that. And he called me one day. And he wanted me, he was taking the road company of Anything Goes out with Leslie Uggams. And he said, I want you to play Moon, whatever. And I said, well, you know, what's the offer? And it wasn't enough for me to go out on the road. I had my home expenses and everything else. But I never forgot that he had asked me. So when he decided that he was going to bring back Guys and Dolls, they came to L.A. and they were auditioning. So I called my agent. I said, you tell Jerry I want to audition for Nathan Detroit. And they said, he's not going to audition yet. I said, why? He said, they're not going to go with the regular type characters that they had. They're going to go real young. And he said, you're too old to play Nathan Detroit. And I said, you tell him that Jamie Farr wants to come in and he wants to audition for Nathan Detroit. Got the phone call back. He said, he'll see you. So we had to come in. You had to read some of the dialogue and then sing a song. And you pick whatever you wanted just to see if you could carry a tune. Well, I did.
Remember what you sang?
Yeah, Singing in the Rain. I couldn't sing then, I can't sing now, and I didn't. They said, I didn't know when I was on Broadway that you could sing. I says, I can't. I did 8 shows a week to prove I couldn't. So at any rate, I didn't hear from them. And I'm in down in Florida doing one of those dinner theater things, and I'm watching television, and I see Nathan Lane playing Nathan Detroit. And I said, boy, he really did go young, because he's supposed to be the sugar daddy to Adelaide. Well, I never thought anything of it. Got back to L.A., phone's ringing. They said, how would you like to do Guys and Dolls? And I said, oh, you mean the road company? They said, no, I'm Broadway. I said, what are you talking about? He said, Nathan Lane's leaving the show, and Jerry Zaks remembered. They all remembered your audition. And they said, let's get Jamie.
Wow.
So off I went to New York. I was so nervous and so frightened. I had 10 days to learn the role. And I couldn't work with the cast because the cast was doing, they were doing their 8 shows a week. So I had to work with the choreographer to learn, sit down, you're rocking the boat, which was a very, very difficult scene. You had to learn the sue me, what could you do me? I had to try to learn the dialogue without the actors and actresses, because what you do, they call you a put-in when you go in, when you replace somebody. And so I would have one rehearsal with the cast before I go on. And I tell you, I was never so nervous and frightened in my life. I mean, it was like trying to catch a runaway train. They had been doing it for such a long time. The nice thing about it is it wasn't the original cast anymore. The other people had been put in. Martin Vidnovic, who I'd done Oklahoma with, was now playing Sky Masterson. Kim Crosby, who I had done Oklahoma with in another version of that, was now doing Sarah Brown. So I had known both of them, and they were great. They brought me along, and after that first show, I can't tell you how nervous I was, and the applause that I got afterwards. I still love that show. Mm-hmm. Still love it to this day.
Could any role have been more different from Max Klinger than perhaps Nathan Detroit?
No. Well, you know, when I was at the Pasadena Playhouse, I had a Shakespearean teacher, and he said, you know, comedians are the greatest tragedians, and we were going to do King Lear. And all these actors, they wanted to do King Lear, and that of the student body, and he picked me, the age of 17, 18 years old. We did two performances. Can you imagine learning King Lear and do two performances? I did my own makeup, and I had some great photographs. I can't find them. I wish I could find them at Pasadena Playhouse. But that's where you get your training. So I did Man with the Golden Arm. I played Sparrow in Man with the Golden Arm. I've done a lot of dramatic things, serious things.
In fact, a couple of years ago, you toured in a one-man show as the great comedian George Burns.
Yes.
You brought that show to Toledo for a couple of shows.
Right.
It was our privilege to be there for one of those, and that night you were George Burns,
I have to tell you.
That had to be a very tiring but a very rewarding experience.
It was very rewarding, yes, it was indeed. And the scary part was coming back to your hometown, because you never want to do that. That's the worst. It's like performing in front of your parents or something like that. I can't tell you. If you think I was nervous doing Guys and Dolls, coming back to Toledo, standing on the stage of that Lowe's Valentine Theater all by yourself, I was really quite nervous and quite frightened. But the reception that I got afterwards, I felt I could do anything after that, as long as I was accepted, you know, by my hometown.
Toledo loved you that night, for sure.
Well, yeah. I know Toledo loves me, but it's another thing performing in front of somebody.
Well, I wanted to ask you, in a TV series like M.A.S.H., Jamie, laughs are often supplied by a laugh track.
Mm-hmm.
But in live theater, you have to impress a live audience.
That's right.
And can you talk about that special feeling of performing live before maybe 2,000 unseen faces?
Well, what it is if you, the thing, what you're always in a comedy is the unknown factor is where the laughs are. Now, the writer writes it, and he or she intends this to be a funny line to get laughter, elicit laughter, but you never know, because regionally, there are different places. Sometimes a joke goes over well, maybe in Toledo, but doesn't go over well in Des Moines, Iowa, or whatever it is. So you have an unknown factor. And the main thing is that what you have to do is bury yourself into the character. Don't go for the laugh. Go for what it is, your objective in the scene. So that's what you try to do. Now, sometimes, after you've done a show, you know that's automatic. That laugh comes there. But then sometimes you get surprised, and you'll find something, and you'll get a laugh out of that wasn't necessarily intended.
Mm-hmm.
And then you build on that. And the more you do the show, I just closed in Kansas City doing a show. That thing, we had that so fine-tuned. We knew exactly how to get to the laugh, get them to laugh again, wait for it. But Jack Benny was the greatest pauser in the world. He would pause,
that deadpan look,
get a huge laugh, and then do something else. And that's what you do. Once you get it, it's skills that you have.
Is there anything better for a performer in a live theater than that live applause?
No, No, but you earn it. Believe me. Doing 8 shows a week, you really have to be focused. You know, television, if we make a mistake or something, you go cut and you redo it. You can't do that in live theater.
I've always marveled at the talents of actors, the ability to memorize all that material, all that dialogue, the range of emotions. I have trouble, Jamie, remembering my Social Security number. How and when did you know that's what you wanted to do? And by gosh, you were pretty good at it.
I never knew I wanted to be an actor, or really never knew that professionally I wanted to be an entertainer. When I was a youngster, I loved movies, and I would go to movies. I didn't know why I liked them. I just loved them. I listened to the radio. I loved listening to the radio, all the comedy shows and that. And as I was growing up and making people laugh, just ad-libbing and doing things, they said, oh, you're going to be another Danny Thomas. And I said, who's Danny Thomas? I didn't even know who he was. And they had to explain to me who he was. He was this man that was in the neighborhood. He was Lebanese, and he was playing in nightclubs, and he was on the radio on the Fanny Bryce show, Baby Snooks. And then they said, why don't you do stand-up? I didn't know what stand-up was. I didn't even know how to write a joke. And I kept seeming to go in those directions, and just making people laugh. And finally, when they finally started to get interested in it, that's when I told you about the Pasadena Playhouse. Well, here's the embarrassing thing. I had my very first scene I had to do at the Pasadena Playhouse was a scene from Mr. Roberts. And they asked me to play Ensign Pulver because they thought that would be a good part since I'm a funny guy. Well, we rehearsed the scene. And I didn't think it was very funny because I didn't know how to make a character work. I just knew how to be funny. So I started changing the dialogue. I didn't think it was funny. The other actor would do that. And the director was going crazy. My coach was going crazy. But I didn't think it was funny. So they said, no, you got to stick to the script. If you're an actor, you got to say what the writer wrote. So that was my first lesson, that you had to take it. And I was an interpreter, you know, not a creator of something.
Well, you certainly have demonstrated your skills as a dramatic actor, and you talked about that. But most people, I suspect, because of M.A.S.H., think of you first and foremost as a comedic actor. Is that all right with you?
Yeah, of course. I love it. That's the only thing I really like to do. I'm going to be doing Tuesdays with Maury up in Canada next year. And I'm going to be... I know. I'll make sure I'll be wonderful in it, and I can do the part and everything else. But you know what? I really enjoy it. It's more fun for me to go out and have fun with a character and get the laughs. At my age, I'm not trying to prove if I can do something. I want to do the things that I enjoy. And that's one of the things that I enjoy.
One of the things you apparently enjoy is going to Canada. You've had a special relationship with Canada over the years with some of your shows.
I know. It seems like Kansas City and Canada, two of the coldest places.
Along with Toledo, apparently.
Yeah, but you know, I always say I got a great agent. He books me in Winnipeg, Manitoba in the winter, and Florida in the summertime. So.
And you still get the crowd, so.
Yep, that's it. That's you know, in television, it's a youth market, and so they use the younger people. In the theater, the people still know who you are, so they come to see you.
You've made a lot of money over the years doing...
Where? When?
Commercials.
Oh, commercials.
I know commercials have enriched you. You've enjoyed doing a very lucrative aspect of your career, right?
It has been, yeah. I wish I could get some more. We'd have to go out on the road so much. I don't want to name a lot of the products, but yeah, that was wonderful. They brought in, they paid for a lot of things at my house. They paid for part of the mortgage and everything else.
Many of us also remember another aspect of your career in the years after M.A.S.H., and that was the game shows that you've been on so many times. You did Password, the $25,000 Pyramid, Hollywood Squares, you did the
$100,000 Pyramid, the Gong Show.
I
must tell you, I can't even remember. They were great, and the reason why I did them, and I used to get criticized from the cast members, because during the time we'd shoot M.A.S.H.
from your M.A.S.H. cast members?
Yeah, because we'd shoot M.A.S.H. 5 days a week, mm-hmm. And then I decided I wanted to do these game shows. And they go, you're beyond that. Why would you want to do a game show? Wait for movies, you know, or a movie for television or something. And here's my idea. See, when you do a TV series, if the people out there don't take time to find out what your name is, they'll just call you by the character name. when you do a game show, your name, Jamie Farr, is in front of you. So they begin to know who you are.
Disassociate you
from the character you're playing. Mm-hmm. So that eventually my name became as important as the character's name. Mm-hmm. I used to do 5 game shows. That's how we did them. We'd take 5 game shows in one day. And my weekends, I do 5 of, let's say, Hollywood Squares, and then 5 of the Gong Show on Sunday, and then report to work on Monday to do M.A.S.H. One time I did 20 game shows in 2 days. I came in to do, I think it was Hollywood Squares, and Ruthie Goldberg came out. She was the casting person for the Gong Show. And she said, "Jamie, one of our stars didn't show up. Can you do 5 of the Gong Shows?" I just done 5 Hollywood Squares. I said, "Sure." So that meant I did 5 Hollywood, 5 Gong Show. One day. Next day I came in to do the Gong Show, which was I was scheduled to do. And as I was coming out after I'd done that, the casting people from Hollywood Squares said, "One of our stars didn't show up. Will you do 5 Hollywood Squares?" I said, "Sure." So I did 20 game shows in 2 days.
That should have held you for a couple of months anyway, I think.
They didn't pay that much. But that's okay. Uh-huh. I enjoyed doing
it. Now, you said all through your career, Jamie, you were determined never to let stardom go to your head, that you did not want to be viewed as a Hollywood snob. And indeed, your connections with your hometown of Toledo prove that's the case, that you did not let that happen. Why was that so important to you?
Well, you know, I went to Hollywood and I saw a lot of these people that were there, and there's a phoniness about them. And I always think, if you're going to be a good actor, you can't let the ego get in the way. You have to have that natural thing. And that's what my key is. I never change. My friend Tom Dreesen, who's a comedian, who was opening act for Frank Sinatra for years, who performed here quite a few times. Tom is from a neighborhood like I came from in Harvey, Illinois, and he was the same way. He's a neighborhood guy. All of us were neighborhood guys. All the people that I know of that came from Toledo that were successful, we're all still friends. We're just neighborhood people. And I think that's important, that you don't lose that. Because I've seen some people that I knew before I went into the Army. They became stars after I got out of the Army. They wouldn't talk to me. I couldn't believe them. Because success went to their heads. Now they're at another level someplace. They don't even want to associate with you.
It's funny you mentioned your service in the Army. A lot of folks don't realize you served time in Korea. But you were with Red Skelton and put on shows.
I don't like the way you said time. I was in the service.
In
I didn't serve time. I wasn't in.
I
wasn't
at
the
was
stockade.
I was in the service, and I did serve time.
No, you did. No, I did. Yeah, I took basic at Fort Ord. Yeah, yeah. I was stationed in. I was stationed in New York City. Stationed in Fort Huachuca, Arizona. Stationed in Fort Knox, Kentucky. Went out of Fort Lewis, Washington, to the Orient. Was stationed in Japan. Stationed in Korea. Back to Japan.
But you did shows in Korea. With,
I did shows
Red
in
Skelton.
Korea with Red Skelton. Red was my mentor. Yeah, mm-hmm. I had done. We didn't touch upon it, but I used to carry half of the Red Skelton show from a couple characters that...
Snorkel?
Snorkel was from a show that I had done that didn't sell, and Cookie was one of the characters, and Sherwood Schwartz, who was the writer for Red Skelton, took those two characters out of the show that didn't sell and made a new character for Red to play. And then, of course, the very first show I ever did with Red, it was about a Korean baby. We're in the Navy together. He finds his Korean baby, and he wants to adopt it, but he has to be married in order to do it. And so he gets the idea of me dressing me up as his wife. Now, this is foretelling something, right? So what he did is I had the lipstick on, he had a wig on me and everything, and we're trying to convince the person at the orphanage that we're man and wife. Well,
they must have seen that episode or something. Oh, people have put together M.A.S.H.
No, they never saw that, but that's ironic that I would do that. But I tell you, Red broke up more times on that show. So I reprised that character, mm-hmm. and then that's when I got drafted into the real Army, so I had to stop doing that.
I want to talk a little bit about your commitment to Toledo. It is so substantial. Your service to your hometown has been demonstrated, Jamie, time and time again. Your golf tournament, all the wonderful charities that it supports. Why is that service to your hometown so important to you?
Well, it's giving back again. It's giving back to the community. When I was growing up, we were so poor, and then do jokes on it, but we were poor. I didn't own a basketball, I didn't own a football, I didn't own a baseball bat, I didn't own a baseball, a softball. And I played in the Grange school playground, and it was gravel, and we used to play in alleys. There were hardly any. I used to belong to Friendly Center. That had a playground to it. So I remember those things, and I figured, well, this is a good way to help out in your own hometown.
Well,
to do something.
Let's talk a little bit about your golf tournament, Jamie Farr Classic, a much longer name, actually, with the sponsors and
right.
so forth. I'll let you say that if you wish.
Well, I have to say it. Jamie Farr Owens Corning Classic, presented by Kroger.
There you go.
Jamie Farr is only the sizzle. The other ones are the substance. They provide the money.
Well,
you better mention.
Yeah, we did. And as we sit here in July of 2009, your Jamie Farr tournament is underway for the 25th
yeah.
year. Are you surprised it's endured that long?
Yeah, I am. I never imagined that it would last that long. And of course, this is for archives, I guess. We're also now at the point where it could be the end of the tournament due to the recession and various other things. So, but it was a fun run, and we collected a lot of money for charities. And I certainly appreciated everybody who supported the tournament, the people who put the money into it, all our sponsors, and all the great volunteers, 1,200 volunteers, some of them have been with us for 25 years, some new ones, and of course the people of Sylvania, Ohio, and Toledo, Northwest Ohio area that are fans, some of the ones that come in from Detroit and even from Cleveland to see the tournament. So we appreciated
now,
everything they've done.
Your friends in the acting community appreciate you. It's clear the LPGA professionals certainly do as well. Your tournament attracts the best women players in the world. Some would say we don't need to characterize it as women's players. Some of the best players of golf in the world.
I would agree with
come
that.
Come to Toledo and play
yes.
in your tournament. That has to be gratifying.
Oh, it is. And it's fun to see them and talk to them and get embraces from them and hugs and kisses and all. It's just been terrific. I've gotten to know many of them personally, Nancy Lopez and Beth Daniel and Meg Mallon and Chris Cheddar and they're just wonderful, wonderful people.
Now, your birthday occasionally falls during the tournament, and I think they've even surprised you a few times out at the tee with a cupcake and a candle in it.
No, it wasn't a cupcake. It was Nancy Lopez, I think Beth Daniel, and Patty Sheehan. I was about to tee off, and they came running out with party hats and party favors and sprayed whipping cream on my golf ball and stuck a lighted candle in it. And I think that was my best shot of the day.
Yeah. So sponsoring the tournament hasn't made you a great golfer?
No. I wasn't good. I always say to them, they don't care how I play golf as long as the check clears after Sunday. That's all they care about.
Your connection with golf, did you aspire as a youngster? You say you didn't have a baseball, you didn't have a bat. Did you ever aspire to be an athlete?
No. I was terrible. I'm a clod, a klutz. I can't sing, I can't dance, I can't play any sports. I was never good at any of those things. But, I mean, who knew golf? I used to read on the blade. Oh, my goodness, they're playing golf at Inverness. Ben Hogan, Jack Nicklaus, Arnold Palmer. Oh my, Byron! Now I didn't know who these people were. I could care less about golf.
How did the tournament come about? I think it was Judd Silverman, obviously.
Yeah, Judd was a caddy for Greg Stadler. I guess Judd went to University of South Florida, loved golf, played golf. I was doing M.A.S.H. at the time. The show was going out of production. I decided to take the game up. Bought a set of clubs. Was looking for a driving range, and I passed Calabasas Country Club and Frankie Avalon and a guy by the name of Louis Gallo, an actor friend of mine, were teeing off on the 18th. I says, hey guys, it's Jamie. I says, is there a driving range here? They said, yeah, but you got to belong to the club. Go up and tell them we're sponsoring you. Go to the clubhouse. So I went up there, bought myself in, used the driving range, and then my friend Don Michael called me, who said, we got this idea about a golf tournament. Would you put your name on it? I had been to the Dinah Shore tournament. Dinah and I were good buddies, played in it, Nancy Lopez, Beth Daniel were the people I played with, and they said, yeah, we patterned it after the Dinah Shore, and I'll do it. But I said, also, I don't want just one charity. It's got to be a wheel that goes around the city, because I didn't want a clique, you know, to take over so that the city wouldn't be involved. So that's how that happened. I wanted a banquet with a big show the way Dinah had it. I wanted celebrities to come. And first year we lost money, haven't lost a dime since.
Yeah, many millions of dollars to worthwhile charities, too. Your wonderful wife, Joy, has been at your side for many years. And you tell us what her support has meant to you and your career.
Well, Joy from a small town, Danville, Illinois, population 40-some thousand people, home of Dick and Jerry Van Dyke, Gene Hackman, Bobby Short, and Donald O'Connor. That's not a bad lineup for that little town. I met Joy. She had just come in from Chicago. And a friend of ours, a mutual Toledoan and Lebanese man by the name of Mitch DeWood. Mitch was a singer, and he'd been with part of a comedy team called Allen and DeWood, Marty Allen and Mitch DeWood. Mitch was leaving Marty Allen. He was going to become an agent. And then it became Allen and Rossi. And Mitch was staying at the Park Sunset apartments. And these two ladies, Joy Richards and Judy West, they were friends that came in from Chicago. And Mitch says, you got to meet this gal. She's terrific. I got to tell you, she is really something. So I met her. I was broke at that time, as I usually was. And I was going to ask her out, but then she fixed me up with her girlfriend, Judy West. Mm-hmm. Well, Judy West and I never got along. I didn't have any money at all, and I think she was looking for better times. So Joy says, you know, I think he's kind of cute. I'll go out with him. So we're still going out 46 years, later. And she was a kind of gal that if I wasn't working, she would work. She said, no, we're gonna do it. I mean, that woman, I got to tell you, there was a time when we first got married, I had gotten a job, and there was a time when the telephone didn't ring for a full year, and she really supported us. Mm-hmm. I was at home. I was cooking. I was doing all that stuff. We had hardly any. I bought a house. When we were going to get married, I kept sending her money home to put away. I was doing the greatest story ever told. Because I always wanted a house. She didn't want a house. She lived in a house. I said, no, I want a house. And we bought this first house, great little house in Studio City. It was $24,500, and I needed $2,450 down. It cost me $150. $130 for the mortgage and $23 for the second mortgage. $153.
Try doing that today.
Yeah, right. And we could only furnish a little bit of the house. We slept on a Riviera pull-out bed for about a year. Had one TV set and that. And then eventually my phone started ringing. But a whole year, I was out of work. Yeah. And without her, we couldn't
have
made it.
Quite a team, obviously. I don't know that there's anything left professionally for you to have to prove, Jamie. But you mentioned you just did a show. Mm-hmm. Are you going to continue touring out on the road, on stage?
Yeah, I think so. You know, the recession came, my 401k disappeared just like everyone else's 401k did. So I was thinking about, gee, wouldn't that be nice if I could just settle down? So I think until it turns around a little bit, fortunately I wasn't with Bernie Madoff, so you didn't have to be with him to lose money.
Right. Yeah. Any chance you'd consider another TV role?
Oh, I love television. I would. That's really what I would like to do, but the offers aren't there because it's a youth market. Everything is a youth market. They look for, that's what advertisers look for, the networks look for, and every once in a while you'll get a part. It's in a TV series that has the grandfather, the uncle, or the father-in-law, or something. But there are very, very few times that happens. But I would love another television series.
Mm-hmm. Now, we haven't had a chance much to talk about this book, Jamie Farr, Just Farr Fun,
yeah,
which you put together. What motivated you to do that?
Well, I had read George Burns' book with his anecdotes in it, and I just thought that was very, very funny, and I loved it. So I thought I had so many different stories to tell over my years in the business that I'd put a book together. Well, I went out to try to get a publisher, and I couldn't find one publisher. They didn't want to print that kind of a book. It was during the time when they were looking, and they still do with books, as a kiss and tell kind of book. Not fun stories, but who's a bad person and who's doing what to whom and drugs, alcohol, or anything else. And I said, forget it. So my friend Bob Eubanks, the game show host I had done game shows with, Larry Donizetti, and I, we published that book. Mm-hmm. I didn't make any money off that book. But you know what? It was a lot of fun. I enjoyed putting it out. And people who read it tell me they think it's great reading. It's
great fun to read. You end the book with a tribute to St. Jude and a prayer. Why did you do that?
I did that because Danny Thomas. Mm-hmm. I don't know if people know the story. I mean, Danny was down and out. He was in Chicago. He couldn't get a job. And he's Catholic. I'm not. I'm Eastern Orthodox. And he used to go in and pray to St. Jude. He said, if you help me out, I will build a shrine to you, and so on and so forth. And, of course, we know the story. Danny became this major star, owner of a studio and television series, and he built the shrine, the St. Jude Hospital in Memphis, Tennessee. Well, I was down and out and out of work at the time before I got The Greatest Story Ever Told, and I had wanted to be in this movie because it was a biblical picture. So I went to my agent and I said, can you get me in this movie with this face? I mean, I got it. That's a perfect for a biblical picture. George Stevens was directing it. So he says, well, I'll try. I mean, my agent, I love this agent, Meyer Mishkin. He was a great agent, had a lot of names. And he managed, he says, look, do you have any serious film that Mr. Stevens can see? And I said, yeah. I did a very serious role in the Western, The Rebel, that my friend Andy Finity had produced, who was from Toledo and Woodward High School. It was starred Nick Adams. I say, played this kind of sympathetic character. He says, get me the film, and we'll have him take a look at it. So I called Andy. He says, I'll call Nick. You go over to Nick's house, pick up the film. Got the film, drove it over to Culver City Studios, left it off, and what I was doing is I had this little car, this little Renault, this is before Joy and I were married, and I used to take her to work in the morning. She was working at an optometrist's office in that, and there was a little Catholic church not far from it. So I used to go in there early in the morning after I dropped her off, and there was a statue of St. Jude. And I says, hey, Danny prayed to St. Jude. I'll pray to St. Jude. He's from Toledo. He's Lebanese. I'll pray. So I used to go in there and pray for a part in this movie and light a candle, put some money in there. Did that every morning. And my agent called me and he said, Jamie, I can't tell you this. I'm sorry to, but there's nothing in the movie for you. Pick up your film. So I picked up the film, took Joy to work that next morning, stopped in at the church and told St. Jude off. Wouldn't light a candle, didn't give him a quarter. And I got really angry at him, and I said, you know, what the heck am I supposed to do? I have the thing and blah, blah. And I, what do you want me to do? Wash dishes, be a waiter, sell shoes? I was really mad at him, and I said, that's it. That's it with you. And I turned around and walked out. I had a phone call from my agent. He says, Jamie, I don't know what happened. He says, but he said, I took this offer. 26-week guarantee at $450 a week. They want you to play the part of the apostle Nathaniel Bartholomew. I said, great. He said, go in tomorrow for wardrobe testing and makeup. So I went into the studio, Charlton Heston and Roddy McDowell and everybody's there. And they put a beard and then the clothes that the apostles wore, and I screen tested. Get a phone call from my agent, Meyer Mishkin. He says, Jamie, everything's still set? 26-week guarantee, $450 a week, but they looked at your screen test, and they want you to play the Apostle Thaddeus. So I says, oh, that's great. I don't care. I didn't see the script, didn't know what the lines were, but $450 a week with a 26-week guarantee. So I call my friend Mitch DeWood, who was dear friends with Danny Thomas, the gentleman who introduced me to Joy. He said, hey, Mitch, I got this part in The Greatest Story Ever Told, 26 weeks, $450 a week. He says, who are you playing? I said, I'm playing the Apostle Thaddeus. He says, who? I said, the Apostle Thaddeus. He says, you know the Apostle's full name? I said, no. He says, it's St. Jude Thaddeus. So I wound up playing the saint I was praying to. That's why
all of a sudden
I
you felt a lot better about Saint Jude.
I felt a lot better, yeah. I couldn't build him a shrine. It was already built, but I do support it. I'm on the advisory board of St. Jude Hospital, professional advisory board.
Jamie, some years ago I had the opportunity to interview Steve Allen, the great comedian.
Sure, I knew Steve.
Songwriter, musician. I asked him what he wanted to be remembered for, and without missing a beat, he said, oh, for about 2 weeks.
Sounds like Steve.
At the risk of being the last straight man, one more time, let me ask you, what would you like to be remembered for?
Laughter. Laughter. People seeing me, that I was always welcome in your house, welcome in your company, just welcome, just being part of your life.
Jamie, thanks for all you do for your hometown.
My
and
pleasure.
Thanks for the precious gift of your time today.
All right, thank you,
Appreciate
Tom.
It very much.
Sure.
And thank you for watching.